My name is Ian Underwood, and I'm the straight member of the group.
Wowie zowie.
1 month ago, I heard the Mothers of Invention at the theater. I heard them on two occasions, and on the second occasion, I went up to Jim Black, and I said, I like your music, and I'd like to come down and play with you. 2 days later, I came up to the recording session, and Frank Zappa was sitting in the control room. I walked up and said, how do you do? My name is Ian Underwood, and I like your music, and I'd like to play with your group. Frank Zappa says, what can you do that's fantastic? I said, I can play alto saxophone and piano. And he said, all right, whip it out.
Today's guest, Ian Underwood, graduated from the Choate School in 1957 and Yale University with a bachelor's degree in composition in 1961 and a master's degree in composition at UC Berkeley in 1966. He began his career by playing San Francisco Bay Area coffeehouses and bars with his improvisational group, the Jazz Mice, in the mid-1960s before he became a member of Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention in 1967 for their third studio album, We're Only in It for the Money. He speaks on Uncle Meat. On the track Ian Underwood Whips It Out, he relates how he first met Zappa and demonstrated his capabilities on the saxophone at Zappa's invitation. Underwood later worked with Frank Zappa on his solo recordings, most notably on Hot Rats. Underwood left the Mothers of Invention in September 1973. After his lengthy career with Frank Zappa, he pursued a career as a session keyboardist. Underwood has since been proficient on the Mini Moog synthesizer, mostly in film. He has been credited in recordings for Quincy Jones, Barbara Streisand, Ronnie Blackley, Freddie Hubbard, Jean-Luc Ponty, Herb Alpert, Hugh Masekela, Peggy Lee, Dolly Parton, Chicago, Janet Jackson, Dave Grusin, Jefferson Airplane, Frankie Valli, The Carpenters, James Ingram, and Barry Manilow. Underwood was also one of the musicians who played the main title theme for the 1980s hit series Knight Rider. Underwood has also been a featured performer with James Horner on numerous James Horner film scores, including Titanic and Sneakers. So let's join the boys as they chat it up and whip it out and other such stuff.
With me, and let me just introduce you to the audience, and I know everybody knows who you are, but you had quite the your whole pre-Frank Zappa experience was incredible. Actually graduated from a few different colleges, Yale being one of them, correct?
Correct, yes, that's
and,
right.
And Berkeley?
And University of California at Berkeley, yes.
Yep. And you started playing in coffee houses in San Francisco, and that was with the Jazz Mice?
There was a local group that I had with a couple of other musicians there, and that was, we called it the Jazz Mice.
Well, and there was no recordings of that, I guess, right?
Oh, no.
Okay.
We played in a couple of local bars, one in particular on San Pablo Avenue, and one time we each got more than a dollar.
Okay, let's go back to the beginning. When did you realize that music was your passion, and this is what you wanted to do, and you wanted to do it as a professional?
Well, that's excuse me, please. That's a little bit of two questions. The I started asking for piano lessons when I was about 7 years old, and but that had nothing to do with professional music.
Right.
And I had private piano lessons for a lot of years, but didn't do anything whatsoever that was professional or even related to professional music. But the time that I got more into, more interested in jazz when I was, like 16 years old, teenager, and, started playing clarinet and saxophone and flute, and, still nothing much out, in public at all.
Yes.
But, when I went to Yale University, that's when I decided that I would that I was not much good for anything else, and I better do music.
Well, you did this pretty well, and obviously your introduction to Frank Zappa was you know, documented on the Uncle Meat album, when you know, and I guess that was the actual. Was that the first time you met Frank?
Well, I met Frank because I went to a concert. I was in New York City, and they were playing at the Garrick Theater.
Yes.
And I had nothing to do one night, and so... I have two sisters, and my, one of my sisters and I decided we wanted to do something. And we looked in the paper. She was living on the Upper West Side at the time, so we were on the Upper West Side. And, we looked in the paper and saw that, a notice about this particular band playing at the Garrick Theater.
Right.
So we said, yes, let's go do that. So, but I, at that time, I didn't know the name Frank Zappa. I didn't know what the Garrick Theater was. I didn't know anything about the, his music, nothing. But we just went out to hear it.
Okay.
So we headed down on the subway and walked over to the Garrick Theater. And I saw... the marquee from a block's distance, and it said absolutely free. And to show you how ignorant I was, I said to myself, oh good, it's a free evening.
Right.
But in any case, we went there, we paid our money, went and sat down, heard the concert, which I can tell you more about, but in basically you were asking me, how did I meet Frank? So I liked the concert, I loved the music, and I simply walked up to the stage, which was a very, Garrick Theater was very, very small.
Right, right, right.
And I just walked up to Frank and said that I liked the music a lot and I would like to play in the group.
Yeah.
And he said, come on up, I'm recording up in, on the, Midtown on the studio, and so I went up with a saxophone and who knows what, a clarinet, whatever I had with me at the time.
Sure, sure.
And that was that. He just set me to doing, he asked me to do you know, a few things, like not what could I do, but would I play B3 organ on this one chart that he had, like a, it was one of the ones for worldly and in it for the money. Anyway,
right, right, right.
Something I obviously, I knew nothing about, hadn't seen before, but it was a chord chart and I heard the music and I played something. So that went okay. And, then he wanted me to play something. He gave, he said, play something on piano here. And it was, da 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 that song, the water turned black.
Yeah, let's make the water turn black.
So yeah, that's right. That's it. I was confusing in my mind with another movie idea. But anyway, not to worry about that. What it needed was piano all along the way, and then something in the introduction,
right?
Or something. I didn't even know if he told me what to play or anything. He just kind of played me the track and then said, "Go."
Uh-huh.
So I, without thinking further, I just played something, and that was okay. And what I did happen to play on the introduction was that little piano figure going up.
Uh-huh.
If you listen to it, you'll hear it.
Yeah.
And that seemed to stick, so that was good. And then I did a bunch of other overdubs, uh-huh, because he had tracks,
right,
but they weren't finished tracks at all.
Right.
And then he said, "Well, okay, you're in. Come on down to the theater."
Wow.
if you want to be in the band. And so,
wow.
So I did, and that was that.
Wow. And you know, and the history that you and Frank had together were incredible. You were on, you know, most of the, you were actually, I consider that the pinnacle of Frank's recording time is the stuff that you pretty much worked on from, you know, I really liked the early Mothers. You hopped in on the third album, I guess, Reeling It for the Money.
Yes, yes, that's right. Yes,
and then,
that's correct.
I mean, you got through 200 Motels, Overnight Sensation, Apostrophe, but you did the actual first Zappa solo record, Hot Rats.
That is correct, yeah.
Yeah, and that obviously was you and him, you know, primarily. That was your, you two actually did that album together. And I don't know if you...
What?
I don't know if you get enough credit for being so influential on that album, but you're all over that album.
As it happens, I am.
Yeah.
And I'm all over that album because I was playing parts that Frank wrote.
Right.
And
yeah, no, I know that.
Of course.
Yeah, yeah.
Being, so I was a performer, not a composer or contributing in that way.
No.
But at the same time, I did a lot of overdubs. You are correct.
So there's
a lot. So in order to build up the texture, that's the way it worked on that album. And I like that album. I think the results were really interesting and really good.
Yeah, it is. It's a great album. And then the last time I think I saw you perform was at the Fillmore East in 71.
That's
the last time I saw you guys perform together. That was with Flo, Flo and Eddie. And I actually worked with Flo and Eddie a few years after that. We, I was involved with a record label, Epiphany Records, and a nightclub in New York called My Father's Place. And we kind of took Flo and Eddie under our wing for a while, and they did a reggae album for us. I don't know if you remember that album, Rock Steady, with Flo and Eddie, the reggae album they did.
I don't know that reggae album, but that's okay. Look it up.
No, don't worry about it. Not too many people do. It wasn't... but the Wailers were on that album, and Augustus Pablo. It was a great album, actually. But the last time I saw you guys was at the Fillmore East, and I was lucky enough to see the John Lennon show, you know, when he came out Saturday night.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I do recall that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I was at both shows that Saturday, the early show and the late show. And actually, I saw you one more time at Carnegie Hall. You were still in the band, right?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. So that's actually the last time. That was after the Fillmore show. It was the Carnegie Hall show. Mm-hmm. I remember that. And that was a great band. It was a great live band. It's a shame you didn't do, more studio stuff with that band. But they were great, So, let's see, let's go back. So, you were involved in Rolling for the Money, Ruben and the Jets, Uncle Meat, Hot Rats, Burt Whitney's Sandwich, and I understand Burt Whitney's Sandwich, that title is yours.
No. Not that I know of.
I thought I read somewhere that you used to eat a lot of hot dogs, and that's what they used to call your hot dogs, Bert Weenie sandwiches, and that's how we could, that's how the title.
I don't think so.
Okay.
I think it's from someplace else.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's.
But I do like that. But I do like that album.
Yeah, it's a great album. It's an incredible album. I think that's one of the best albums. I spoke to Bunk the other night, and we were talking about that as well. That the Mothers of Invention, I think, was Frank's probably best performing band in all. It might not have been the most technically sound band. He did definitely had musicians that might have been better towards the end, but the original Mothers of Invention definitely had a heart and soul to it that I don't think the other bands had.
Well, it had. I wouldn't totally use those words, but it had the personalities in the band and the way at that time that that Frank wanted to sort of let those personalities be part of everything that was going on.
Yeah,
was really interesting. It was really lively. It was really sweet, actually.
Uh-huh.
It wasn't just like better or worse or that kind of thing. It really had a nice, lovely feel to it.
Right. More like a gang than a band, right?
I would say it was a band, but those elements were certainly, you know, part of it.
Yeah.
However, even when I after the band started touring and doing really big concert halls, like in Europe,
yes,
and in London,
uh-huh,
Royal Albert Hall, etc., where it's a big space. Frank had never played in big spaces like that. The band had never played in big spaces like that.
Right.
So by and by, as as time went on, Frank felt that the byplay and the gags and the sort of interaction of the band that really worked well in the Garrick Theater, which was a small space,
yes,
wasn't working. There were two points. It wasn't working so well in a large space.
Uh-huh.
And the other point was that people were now, it wasn't like 10 people a night coming, you know, playing $2.
Right.
It was a lot of people paying a lot of money to see the show,
right,
and Frank felt that it ought to be not left so much up to chance,
uh-huh,
like whether something would work or something wouldn't work. So there was that element, but along with that was the fact that Frank was basically, besides being a great guitarist, you know, by any definition of that word,
sure,
but he was a composer, and he played guitar like a composer.
Okay.
He created his solos were, that doesn't mean to say they were pedantic, it means just to say that they had the shape of somebody thinking like a composer,
right,
not necessarily like a player, you know, putting wonderful licks together or anything like that.
Uh-huh.
So that was Frank as a player and composer player, but the band was his compositional tool.
Okay.
As well as anything else. So it wasn't just a band of, you know, like most bands are.
Uh-huh.
It was sort of it was really, that's why it's all about Frank. Because he is the composer, and so even that band with all its frivolity and wonderful, you know, side tracks,
yes,
which were absolutely wonderful and wonderful to watch and wonderful to be around. At the end of the day, that was Frank's compositional tool, just like everything else in his life.
Right. Well, I remember him saying something to the effect that he was a capitalist and that his band was his tool to generate income, and the musicians were tools to generate income. And, you know, he pretty much laid it on the line that he expected his musicians to be able to make him money so that when you did pay to get a ticket to see him and the band, you felt like you got your money's worth.
Yes.
Yeah. And
that's right.
Yeah. And I mean, that makes a lot of sense. And I know the musicians that he started picking up along the way were a lot more, there were more of them that were able to transcribe music and read music and, you know, write music and transpose music and the whole bit. And his bands were getting more and more proficient. They really were.
Correct.
I saw him many a times. I saw him with the Awaka Jawaka, that small orchestra he took out on the road, when Jim Gordon was playing drums at the time. Then I saw him, with some of the later bands and all that stuff. So yeah, his bands definitely kept getting more and more proficient. And you seem to have been able to, cut it with him. You were the type of guy he was looking for. I think if he could have had a band of all of yous, guys like you, he would have been, that's what he was looking for.
Well, I think that is true.
Yeah.
And up to a certain point, that really worked well for, my abilities in that area worked well for Frank and
right.
for me. It was great.
Yeah.
I've been listening. I didn't for a long time. But after I left the band, I didn't pay any attention to what Frank was doing at all.
Right.
Period.
Right.
That was not for me. That was done. It wasn't a negative.
Yeah.
Statement, in my mind. It was just that I was definitely going in a different direction, and I started doing studio work in L.A.
Right.
and so on. But because I was just in this other world, well, not because of it. It's just that I shifted my attention, and it wasn't because of Frank or because of the music, but I wasn't interested ever in being a rock musician.
Right, right.
There wasn't any point in my life that I had in mind that I would be a rock musician at all.
No.
The only reason I, out of pure happenstance that I was playing with Frank was that I heard him one night.
Yes.
And what he was doing with the band was like everything that was going on in my head that I liked.
Okay.
Which I had not encountered before, because I was either in a classical world or I was in a jazz world or, some other world.
Well,
each of which was separate from the other, and here was Frank combining everything.
Yeah. Well, back in 1968, when you hooked up with Whirling for the Money, let's see, 55, I was 13, and I was so impressed. First of all, you came into the band, you didn't look like you belonged in that band. You know what I'm saying? You the other guys were, Mothers of Invention, and you came in and you kind of brought a little class to the band, if I could use that word. You know what I'm saying? You look like a guy who's really serious about the music. And I wanted to grow up to be Ian Underwood, to be honest with you. It was
Oh, dear.
Yeah. I mean, you played all the instruments. I'm a keyboard player. I play clarinet. I play a little saxophone. And, you were it for me. I thought you were, you were great. And then once, I got a little older, you got a little older, went through the Chunga's Revenge stage, all that other stuff. Burnt Weenie was incredible. But I'm telling you, when Hot Rats, listening to Hot Rats, even back then, I was a little older, and I was really, really into music and everything. I kind of knew back then that he was a great guitar player, but he wrote everything, and it was all his, but he couldn't have done Hot Rats without you on that album.
Well, I think he, my feeling is he could have, for sure.
Uh-huh.
But I also, there were a lot of years where I didn't really also listen to any of the albums I ever played on. I just didn't.
Right.
But recently, since Joe Travers and the Zappa Trust put out the uh-huh. Hot Rats, and since Joe, contacted me about that. So I've been in contact basically somewhat more in the last couple of years with the Zappa family and with Joe Travers
sure.
and his band, his current Zappa band and all that. So all that's wonderful and I'm liking that. But I hadn't listened to Hot Rats for a long time, so it was quite interesting and
trip down memory lane.
Educational.
Yeah.
To listen back to all, to the final results and to all the basic tracks. Of course,
sure.
I remember all, everything about it pretty much. And and at first I didn't really have much of a feeling about it. I mean, I always liked Hot Rats. I thought, well, that's fine. And then I moved on.
Sure.
I felt that it was something that I could do at that time really well, and it really just locked in with what Frank wanted to do at
right.
that time.
Do you think
so? I'm willing to say that my contribution was all positive and all good, but I certainly don't think that Frank could not have made the movie.
No, he definitely could.
Record without me.
No, you know what I mean. He could have done the album with anybody, but he was darn lucky to have you on part of the team at that time. I mean,
Well, I think it worked well.
Yeah, it did.
I'm sure for both of you it worked out well.
I'm just trying to say, Ian, you were fantastic on that album. I mean, you really were. And
well,
Frank could have done it with anybody. He could have done it with me, but he was lucky to have you. You know what I mean? You were at the right place at the right time with Frank at that time, and I think it really.
Yeah,
shows.
Well, I have that.
And and I've been listening to the Hot Rats, the reissue now too, the sessions, and I think it's great. I think they did a pretty nice job on that.
I think my opinion is that Amit uh-huh. and Joe Travers did a really, really good job on
yeah.
that particular package. Although I think they do a really good job on all the packages that they're putting out these days.
Yeah, I do too. But the 1970 I'm sorry, you continue.
Well, I mean, Joe Travers is the Vaultmeister,
yeah.
But he is an immensely talented musician and drummer,
yeah,
and really, really a wonderful person. So there's a lot going on there. It's not just these guys are putting this stuff out. This is the reason it's so good is because these people are really, really, really wonderful musicians and very thoughtful.
I know they're not just putting out garbage because it's sitting there. They're actually putting out something that makes sense, and they are. Even the 1970 set that just came out is pretty interesting.
It did, yeah.
It's interesting. I mean, I personally like the Hot Rats sessions better, But, you know, that's me. And I really like that, Flo and Eddie band. You know, I'm in love with Flo and Eddie. You know, the great guys and everything else.
I do,
else.
Yeah.
But I think that Hot Rats session box, it's really, really brilliant. It's a brilliant set. And, again, I'm going to say it one more time, then we'll move on. You guys are lucky to be working together.
I would say so.
Yeah, just take the compliment.
I take the compliment.
There you go.
And I thank you.
Yeah, I've been talking to tons of Zappa alumni, Ed Mann and Scott Tunis, everybody, Arthur Barrow, and Robert Martin the other night. Everybody who's been out on the road, either doing these Zappa tribute things or the hologram things, whatever they've been doing. They all came up with the same kind of a feeling that when you played, who was telling me, just maybe it was Robert, that he played with you a few times. You had joined.
Actually, recently.
Yeah,
and because Joe's band has been playing at the Baked Potato and at a couple of places in L.A. a few months ago.
And they said when you got on stage, it was magic. It just kind of, he said they're a tight band. They do great work every night. But when you came on, it brought out the sparkle in everybody. And what they said, what you contributed was like uncanny. You kind of brought a new life to the band. And whoever worked with you, I just want to let you know, they all have the highest opinion of you. And I think that's great. It's just kudos to you that you left such an important mark, with the Frank Zappa legacy.
Well, it's very nice. I mean, I never think of it in terms of importance or anything like that, but first of all, it's very nice to hear that they felt like that or anything in that area, which is great.
Yep.
But I will also say, I will also say that from my point of view, once again, everything is luck. Who knows what's going to happen in the next 10 seconds, right?
Sure, yeah.
Joe had asked me, would I feel like sitting in with the band? And I kept saying, this was back more, before any of these things happened, but only like early this year, sort of in January.
Uh-huh.
Joe and I were talking, and we were just saying, I said, I don't know, I haven't played I have played this kind of music in a very, very long time. So in my own mind, I'm thinking, well, I know I could do it, but I don't know if I really should do it. I mean, should I just go and see the concerts and and enjoy it that way?
Sure.
But I finally found myself actually, for better or for worse, wanting to do it.
Good.
I'd heard the band, before I actually played with them one set of times down there. And so I knew what was going on. And I did play with them.
Right.
And it was great. I just absolutely loved it. And there are a number of particular things that I loved. I loved the band itself. I loved all the people in the band.
Right.
I'm not saying that I know them so well. I'm getting to know them better.
Uh-huh.
But they're all as people. They're just like splendid, wonderful
aren't
people.
They? Yeah, they are.
Very, very generous hearts. Very generous, souls, and also. They are, as it turns out, musicians, because they played this music of Frank's before,
yes,
a lot, and they know it backwards and forwards.
Right.
That band, that particular band. I'm not making comparisons. With anything else. I'm just saying.
Sure.
That particular band, and I eventually I told I told Joe, because I just said, well, what's the point of not telling him my opinion anyway? I said, this is an extremely special band. It's yeah. not just a band of good players playing the music. There's more to it than that.
Uh-huh.
And what there is to it is each person in the band is let's see the best way to put it. Each person in the band, I mean, this isn't like unusual, like, you know, string quartets, everybody's yeah. good, everybody contributes. So
yeah, yeah.
I'm not saying that this is something different from anything else, but I'm just saying, actually, this band, everybody in the band, when they play what they play and the parts of the solos and when they are on stage, like their own projection of the music, it's pretty uncanny how uh-huh. absolutely unusual and wonderful it is. It's right. just great. So I only want to say also that I felt that I was, you know, it was, I was sort of honored and very, very, very happy to be playing on the same stage with those guys. It was
yeah,
a
yeah.
wonderful, wonderful
experience. And they felt the same way. They really did. And, I mean, it's great. So, let's see, Robert was in that band, Robert Martin?
Absolutely, Robert yeah, Martin, yes.
That's who I spoke
yeah.
to. Yeah, Robert was telling me that. And was Andre working with them at the time? Andre Chumley? Or Ed? Who was playing guitar?
No. Okay, so hold on now. Just give me a second.
Yeah.
Let me remember what I'm doing here. Okay, so who was playing guitar was, hang on a second, because I am going to tell you.
Was it Ed?
When I no. It was Mike Keneally.
I mean Mike, yeah, Mike Keneally, right, okay.
Mike yeah, the band essentially was, I made a note of it so I could just, yeah. wouldn't just forget, but it was Joe Travers, of course,
right.
Scott Tunis,
yep.
and Robert Martin playing yep. keyboards and yep. saxes and vocals,
yep.
Mike Keneally,
great.
Sort
Mike's
of
a
all
guitarist.
The same, lead guitar, keyboards, and vocals. Ray White, oh my God.
Ray's incredible,
fabulous.
Yeah.
Guitar and vocals, and if there were there were some guests
right.
also, who, and was Toshi Yanagi, the guitar.
Okay.
Was also playing, uh-huh. and who is also very, very, very fabulous person and guitarist.
Right.
Really amazing.
Yeah. Well, so I think I spoke to Joe, but I spoke to everybody. Mike's going to be phoning in a couple of weeks, but I spoke to everybody in that band, I think. Ray White's a lunatic. He's incredible. He's the funniest guy around. And what a talent.
Yeah.
A beautiful, great singer. I don't know if you heard his new album.
Yes.
It's like a slow jam album that he put out. It's actually...
I didn't. So I'm glad you've told me about it because I will now get busy on that. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's really, really good. It's a good album. And I spoke to Scott. In fact, when I spoke to Scott, I was trembling because they told me Scott is going to eat you alive. And when I got to Scott, I said to him, "Hey Scott, listen, I'm scared crapless talking to you." I said, "I'm laying my cards out." I said, "I understand that you're the toughest of the tough." And I said, "Well, you know something, you know, I could get pretty ugly too. So let's make this thing as easy as possible." He started laughing. He said, "Now that's great." He said, "Don't worry about it. That's the old me." You know, and we laughed for
yeah.
2 hours. Scott's a great guy.
Yeah.
What a talent. You know, Robert's incredibly talented. It is a great band. Is that the band that's going to be going out with King Crimson when things buckle
that
down?
That is the band that is supposed, was supposed and now is supposed next year to go out with King Crimson.
Yeah, because such a great band. So, you know, Mike, I spoke to Mike, just, you know, 2 minutes here, 2 minutes there, and he's a great guy, too. And what a talented player. And I think, you know, these guys are really going to represent the Zappa legacy, you know, to the utmost. And are you going to make any appearances with them by any chance?
Nobody has said anything about that, or we haven't talked about it, but I suppose if it was brought up and it was desired for any reason, I might I would definitely consider it. I wouldn't say no away. It would be a super pleasure and just a complete honor to be playing with those guys.
Sure. Let's talk about some more of your history. I didn't realize till recently you produced the first Alice Cooper album.
I would say that when I was first working with Frank, I did a variety of things sort of like that Frank wanted to, you know, tried me out on, let's say. But I would say, as a producer of Alice Cooper, I would say I was probably close to a zero in terms of contributing to that. And so, yes, I may have done that, but it was not anything that was a big job, you know, to undertake and so on.
Yeah, because they were a tough band at the time. They weren't too musically proficient for that, you know, when you guys hooked up with them, right? They were new.
No, they were brand new at that time. Yeah, and Frank had some other artists like Sandy Hurvitz.
Yes.
At that time, you know, who were all new. You know, new people that were around at the time, and he, you know, undertook to produce a record of theirs.
Yeah. Also, you worked on Trout Mask Replica. Well, I guess the whole band did that, right?
Well, actually, I would say. Now, how do you say I worked on Trout Mask Replica? How about that? How do you say that? Am I credited?
Oh, I don't know if
I can't be credited.
No, but didn't the Mothers back up a lot of that?
No, Trout Mask Replica is 100% Captain Beefheart and Don Van Vliet and his band.
Okay, so you guys had nothing.
There's nothing. Well, we had nothing. No, the Mothers, me, myself, I had nothing to do with it.
Really?
I did know Don, and I did know the people in the band, mm-hmm. because I used to go out to the West Valley and hang out with them a little bit and play, I think even guitar, which I don't play, but it didn't matter in that band. But I wasn't really playing with the band, but I did hang out with them, and I just loved that whole experience.
With
Hardy Tripp and Captain Beefheart and Don and all the people in the band. It was really terrific. But as far as Trout Mask Replica album, which I am a huge fan of,
me
I think
me
it's
too.
One of the all time important albums.
Yep.
But I had nothing to do with that album.
Okay, because some of the stuff that I doing some of the research, attributes you to that album as well. Okay.
Yes, and I wonder why. I would be curious to hear why that is.
It doesn't even say what you did on the album. It just says that you were, you know, that you were involved with that.
I was involved with the band at the time, but not just in the way I said.
Okay. Then obviously you worked on Jean-Luc Ponty's King Kong album.
Yes, I did.
Okay, so that's right. And then let's just get to some of the other stuff. I know you worked with Flo and Eddie. You did two albums with Flo and Eddie, which were great albums. You did some country western stuff, Porter Wagoner and Dolly Parton.
That is true.
Yeah.
Oh, and the word some is correct. It wasn't it was just maybe a few overdubs or something like that. I can't really totally remember, but that was because of Mike Post,
who probably
produced it. And okay. I knew Mike Post, and I was doing sessions for him, and he was a friend as well.
Sure. Then, a lot of the stuff you did was pretty much, a lot of the studio you worked with, Alfonso Johnson, great artist, Herb Alpert, and you, Masukela. You even worked with Barbara Streisand?
I did, a few times, a couple times. And what was it? Tell me the album that you're talking about that I worked with her.
Songbird?
Okay.
It's 1978.
Yeah, that would be right.
Yeah.
And that has some arrangements by John Mandel, I think.
Yeah, how about Peggy Lee? That too, right?
Peggy Lee is kind of a different thing. I did do one thing totally out of left field for me because I wasn't really doing
record-ish
stuff, but she did an album, and I was hired to be the piano player on the album.
Cool. So, I mean, who else can say they had the gamut ran from Peggy Lee to Frank Zappa? That's an incredible repertoire.
Well, I suppose, oddly enough, it is.
Yeah, it really is. And then I understand that the latter, after all of that stuff, you really got heavy into film music, film scores.
Yeah, that I was doing more of that. And by, I was doing more of that than anything.
Okay, and how did that evolve?
Well, it evolve is the right word. I didn't know anything about studio musicians and studio music, that sort of thing, studio recording. And I was basically looking for a job when I left the Mothers, when I left Frank. And so I got started, I just kind of got it. I was in contact with a few different people in LA who gradually steered me to the point where I got hired by to do a mod squad by Earl Hagen. Earl Hagen was the king of television composers at that time.
Okay.
And he was interested in, he always was interested in the newer possibilities that were available, all possibilities. Very, very, very smart guy, very, very talented and busy. And he had a couple of instruments a Yamaha CS80 and an ARP 2600 that he had bought, but he didn't know how to use them.
Okay.
So he asked me to come over. Would I come over and show him a few things? So I did one day, and I showed him about, let's say, 8 different things, give or take, on each of the instruments, and, a few other things, whatever it was. And then I didn't hear from him for about 2 or 3 weeks, but then I got a call from this thing that I didn't know what it was because I'd never even heard of it, called The Service.
Uh-huh.
And the Service is... perhaps you know exactly what it is, but there were several answering services that put out calls that contractors would make on behalf of composers.
Okay.
So a composer would tell the contractor, I want to do such and such a session, I want so many musicians, and then the contractor would get the musicians and say, call them and confirm that the musicians would play. So I was hired and via that, and I went and did the first job, and Earl Hagen had written in his cues for that day for Mod Squad, had written and used every single thing that I had told him. every patch, every synth patch, and not in a background way, in a solo way, way out front. And he used it to great effect. They weren't all weirdo patches, but they all had some emotional content to them.
Okay.
You know, in terms of what they sounded like. So after that, I had a great time at that session, and so once then I was known to be okay as far as Earl was concerned, which meant that I was okay as far as anybody was concerned.
Right.
At that moment.
Wow.
So then Sandy DeCrescent, who was, started, and other people started hiring me for just the kind of work that was going on, like records, like TV shows, like TV movies, yes. like films.
Yeah.
And the first film I got very, very shortly after doing the Mod Squad was the Iger Sanction.
Oh, wow.
And that the composer of that was John Williams.
Right.
So I was hired to do keyboard and who knows what. I don't remember exactly, you know, sure. but nothing super special, but just hired. And after that, since I was able to do that, then I did a lot of various things, including Streisand, let's say, from time to time. And John Mandel would call me now and then because he kind of knew my background in rock and jazz and stuff like that. And so gradually I did, once I started working with James Horner.
Right, James Horner.
Which was in the early 80s. After that, after the very first job I did for James, then I pretty much did every film that James did.
Yeah, yeah.
And so that was a lot of films because James was working all the time. And after a while, all the other work kind of fell away and I was really basically wound up doing just James, which suited me fine.
Right, right.
It was wonderful, but he was of course a wonderful composer and friend, and we had a lot of similar interests, and also all the people around him in the basic crew and in the orchestra, all very, very high level people, wonderful at their job.
Sure.
And wonderful people. So I was totally happy with that situation.
Well, perfect. And just to pick one out, I know you worked on Blade Runner.
I did a very, yes, I did. But I probably did one session, like an overdub, like way at the end of the process to add some kind of sound, which I no longer have any idea what it was, but right, I guess it was something, and I guess since I did the session, my name is attached to it. So okay. I did do it.
Okay, because
I do like the film, but yeah. I didn't do a lot of work on it. I wasn't any, you know, part of any big process.
Because that is a great soundtrack, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah,
yes, it is.
Yeah, and it's, you know, and you know, it's Vangelis, right? Vangelis did that.
I think so.
Yeah, yeah.
But,
and,
if I'm wrong.
And he's a great, you know, synth player. And so it's great, you know, that you got to work, you know, on some of his stuff. That's incredible.
Yes, I'm not even sure. I'm not sure how it happened, but I guess it happened, you know, another day in life.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, you have to learn how to say thanks. You all have to say, yeah, I was great on that, wasn't I? That's all you have to say. But no,
if I could remember what I did.
I know. But you were on some great movie, you know, House of Cards.
Yes, all that is true. Every movie that James did has value to it. I did quite a few movies with John Williams.
Yeah.
And
Titanic.
Perhaps you. And Titanic. So do you remember Close Encounters of the Third Kind?
Sure. That's right.
That was the movie.
Yeah, that's you, right?
Yeah, da 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 da.
Yeah, that's you. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's right.
I mean, it's not only me.
No.
The orchestra. It's Tavi Johnson too.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not saying every time you hear that that's me, but
yeah.
Essentially, yeah. Yes, I was hired to do that, so that was wonderful.
Yeah, Aliens.
Aliens, yes.
Yeah, from Field of Dreams. I mean, it's great movies. So what's next for you? What are you still doing soundtracks?
No, I am not working out in the great world at this time.
No,
but I am. What I'm doing just totally for myself is doing something that I never ever had a chance to do while I was working, because I was working so much all the time, so many hours on and on and on. I'm actually practicing piano. So I'm very happy doing that. And I'm also, to some extent, I'm definitely in contact with Joe Travers and the Zappa Trust and the various people in the Zappa family. And I'm, which I wasn't for a very, 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 very long time.
Right.
And so I'm extremely pleased about that.
Good. Perfect. And, I guess Amit, right, helps run that trust?
Amit doesn't help run it. He does run it. He is the head of the trust.
Yes. Okay, cool. And I understand he did an incredible job with the hologram tour. I'm really sorry I wasn't able to see that, but I understand that was pretty interesting.
I think it was probably very interesting. I actually went up to their office, to the Zappa Trust office in sort of south of Hollywood a little bit, and visited and hung out with Amit and the various people there in the office.
Right.
And at that time, it was almost less than a month before the tour actually started. So it just so happened that he played me, he showed me all the graphic stuff that was going to be displayed.
Wow.
At the Zappa Trust office.
Yeah.
So I was very, very happy to see that, very interested, and I really liked what he had done. It was a tremendous amount of work, and it was really interesting, and it looked like it was going to be great. So
yeah, I understand. It was.
I think it turned out well.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I was nowhere near. I'm in New Mexico now, and it came nowhere near me. But
that's right.
Yes, I spoke to a lot of guys who were on the tour, and they said it was great playing with Zappa again every night. Scott told me, you know what it's like playing Apostrophe with Frank every night? You know, it was an incredible experience. And, I'm glad it worked out. I'm glad that Frank's music is still out there, that, you know, a lot of people are covering it, that it's getting the respect it always deserved. Probably it's respected more now than it was when he was doing it.
I think that's probably true, yeah.
Yeah, and, I think that he would be very happy knowing that, he left his mark on the musical world, that he's part of history in a big way, part of music history in a big way. And
absolutely, yeah.
And just remember, you guys, you were there with him, and that's, that's, I'd be pretty proud of that. I really, really loved your music, and I'm really, really thankful that you spent this time with me today. And I'd like to...
Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, I'd like to invite you to this next thing that I'm going to be doing. I'm trying to get all the old Zappa alumni and mothers together and do a Zoom call with everybody. And, think about it. You don't have to give me an answer now. It's not going to be for a while. You have time to think about it. But I'd love to have you on board with us. And... also, I don't know if you're interested in this. A lot of the guys are coming back and doing an hour of DJ work, picking their favorite songs that kind of inspired them and stuff that helped them, you know, get their musical footing in the old days. Would you be happy? Would you be interested in that? And that too, think about, you know.
I will think about it. Yeah, I'm not sure if I am, but now that you put it to me like that, possibly.
Yeah. I mean, it's not, you know, like I'm not. You know, I want you to think about it. Take your time. Think about it. Robert Martin.
I will.
Yeah, Robert Martin's doing one in a couple of weeks. Ed Mann's doing one, and it's just like this. You know, like I tell everybody, whoever wants to read the dope on Zappa, there's enough books out there. I don't have to, you know, stir the pot. That's not what I'm doing. You know what I'm saying? There's enough out there where you can, you know, dig and come up with your own conclusions. I'm just here to keep the legacy alive and talk about the music. That's what I'm here for. So again, I'm not here to, you know, find out if Frank was a good boss or a bad boss. That's in books. I'm just here to keep everybody happy and keep the music alive. So think about it, and I'll.
Okay. Well, good for you.
Yeah. And we could discuss it in the future. You know, I'll write you. I'll and again, thank you. And if anything I can do for you, just please let me know, because I appreciate the time you spent with me today.
Well, thank you very much, and it was a pleasure.
Thank you, my friend, and I'd love to do this again. So please stay safe, and we'll talk soon.
Okay, same to you. Okay. Stay safe, and talk to you soon.
Okay,
bye-bye.
Bye-bye. We'll be right back.